The Montreal Protocol started the phase out of R22, and no new equipment was manufactured using R22 starting in 2010. They allowed some production of R22 to continue up until January 1st, 2020, when all production of R22 ceased. Anyone servicing existing R22 equipment is doing so with the existing stockpiles of R22. There's no ban on the use of R22, just the manufacturing of more R22 refrigerant or new equipment using it. The next big change came in an amendment from the conference in Kigali, Rwanda, called the Kigali Amendment. This amendment focused on phasing down the use and production of HFC refrigerants like R410A and other high GWP refrigerants. R410A has a higher value than R22. As you can see, 2088 global warming potential GWP versus 1810 for R22. As part of the 2020 COVID stimulus bill, the American Innovation and Manufacturing Act, AIM, was passed, giving the EPA authority to regulate based on global warming potential, GWP, instead of ODP. The focus now was on lowering the GWP of the refrigerants in use. The industry has known this for some time and has been working on alternatives. In 2010, the US and Canada focused on moving from R22 to R410A based on ODP. That was ozone depletion potential. Now the focus appears to be on GWP, global warming values. Some of the EPA-approved refrigerants being suggested for unitary equipment are R32 and R454B, which have GWPs of 675 and 466, which are much lower than both R22 and R410A. R32 is used in other parts of the world outside of USA and Canada, so some manufacturers are pushing for its use, while others are promoting R454 because of its lower GWV value. If you live in California, CARP, the California Air Resources Board, has a more aggressive timetable to meet these phase-out requirements. Depending on whether there is a federal mandate that all states comply with or whether some states seek a more aggressive phase-out schedule is still to be determined. But California has always been aggressive when it comes to energy and the environment. So what is the timeline for the phase-out of R410A? The EPA set a target of 85% reduction in 15 years, but California just might require that refrigerants used in unitary equipment not exceed a GWP of 750 by January 1st, 2025, which is slightly more aggressive than the AIM Act. This chart is based on R410A and the phase-out percentages suggested over the 15-year period. The use of these new A2L refrigerants will require that the building codes of state, cities, and municipalities be updated before the widespread adoption. The majority of these requirements will be written into UL 6335-2-40 3rd edition, ASHRAE 34, ASHRAE 15, and ASHRAE 15.2P for residential. There are two classes of toxicity, Class A or Class B. Class A is lower toxicity and Class B is higher toxicity. Flammability has four classes, 1, 2L, 2, or 3, with 3 being the highest flammability. The proposed new refrigerants, that is R32 and R54B, are classified as A2L refrigerants which are slightly more flammable than R22 or R410A, which are classified by ASHRAE 34 as Class A1 refrigerants. Some quick facts about R32 and installing. Daikin started using it in late 2012 in Japan, and they state there are approximately 160 million AC units worldwide running on R32 as of June 2021. The design pressures are very similar between R32 and R410A. R32 is lighter than air, so will seek to settle lower in the room. R32 can be charged in either liquid or gas state. During installation, make sure there is good ventilation and no smoking. Follow refrigerant and equipment manufacturers' installation instructions for safety. When repairing an indoor unit, a draft needs to be created between the indoors and outdoor. Check to see that the room size meets the minimum requirements for the R32 unit. Oftentimes they have charts, which we'll show in a minute. R32 is slightly more flammable and will burn when its concentration is between its lower flammability limit of 13.3% and its upper flammability limit of 29.3%. Daikin has chosen R32 for its AC units and currently sells them outside the U.S. market, while Trane has apparently chosen to use R454B. You have already been using R32 if you didn't already know it, as R410A is made of 50% R32 and 50% of R125. It's just now you'll be using the pure version of R32. Sizing charts and graphs by the manufacturer. In order to ensure that you don't exceed the allowable flammability levels, you'll need some form of calculation based on the room size and the quantity of refrigerant in the proposed system. Manufacturers will hopefully produce simple-to-read charts that indicate the acceptable room size per refrigerant charge, as Daikin has done in this chart here. As you can see, for this particular European model of their wall-mounted unit, there is a curve on the chart that indicates the minimum room size. This chart is in kilograms, which is basically equivalent to 2 pounds. You can see by the chart, if you have 2 kilograms, or approximately 4.4 pounds of refrigerant, you'll need a room size minimum of 4 square meters. And you can see by the chart, if you have under 1.224 kilograms, or approximately 2.7 pounds of refrigerant, then there are no floor area restrictions. So what tools are required for R33? If you're changing from R22 to R32, you got to realize R32 operates at a higher pressure than R22, and R32 uses a different type of oil. The oil from the R22 system could cause sludge or other issues. Therefore, all the tools used for your R22 systems should not be used for R32, such as your gauge manifolds and hoses. Have a dedicated manifold and hoses just for your R32 systems. Now, if you're changing from R410A to R32, since R32 has similar operating pressures and oil properties as R410A, the use of separate manifolds and hoses isn't required, if so stated by the tool manufacturer. So now that we know that R22 is so much different than the new R32, you won't be able to replace just one component of an R22 system with that of an R32 system. If you replace an R22 outdoor unit, you'll need to replace the coil also. But you may be able to use the refrigerant piping, which should be cleaned. So what happens if you exceed the lower flammable limit of the refrigerant being used in relationship to the floor area it serves? It's not a problem in a small system, but as the refrigeration system gets larger, there will be a corresponding need to ensure that any of the rooms served are large enough to handle a catastrophic leak and stay within the LFL limits. If you exceed those limits, then you'll need some form of mitigation strategy, like a continuously circulating supply fan, to help dilute the leak, or you'll need a leak detection system. Using a leak detection system will activate several key functions to ensure a safe environment. The leak detector, when activated, can ensure that the supply fan is locked to run continuously to dilute the space while at the same time turning off the compressor to avoid pushing more refrigerant into the space, and close any safety shutoff valves in the refrigeration system to stop the bleeding of refrigerant into the space, while opening zone dampers to allow more air circulation. Refrigerant systems located within a closet or whose volume of refrigerant is large may require natural or mechanical ventilation. Various refrigerant leak detectors are currently being evaluated by the Air Conditioning, Heating, and Refrigeration Technology Institute. The Institute is assessing the capabilities of currently available refrigerant detectors to meet the response time required by the safety standards, with set points determined in a manner to meet the safety standard, considering related issues such as upper detection limits, accuracy and calibration, drift over time, sensitivity to environmental conditions like temperature, pressure, humidity, and vibration. If you like that video, please give it a thumbs up and subscribe to our channel. Thank you.